Well, folks, welcome to our panel. This is Ed Reform Post-Obama, and I'm pretty sure they wrote that title before the election. So this is actually Ed Reform in the time of Trump and DeVos. I'm Richard Whitmire. I'm the author of the Founders, which is a book about the origins of the high-performing charter schools. And today we're going to have a discussion among the panelists here for roughly 30 minutes, and then we're going to turn it over to you folks. So please come up with some good succinct questions for us. And I'll probably take questions first from slido.com, which I'm sure some of you have already used. If not, go to slido.com and enter it in, and you'll get your questions crowdsourced. A brief introduction of our panel here. Nina Rees, on my right, is president of the National Alliance for Public Charter Schools, a nonprofit committed to advancing the charter school movement. Charters have grown into a major force in education reform. Today, there are more than 6,900 charter schools in 43 states and Washington, D.C., educating more than 3.1 million students. By 2020, the Alliance predicts that 10,000 charter schools will be serving over 4 million students. Rees is a former first deputy undersecretary for innovation improvement at the U.S. Department of Education. There, she was responsible for overseeing innovative federal programs and policies such as school choice, charter schools, and alternative routes to teacher certification and school leadership. Next, Eva Moskowitz is founder and CEO of Success Academy Charter Schools, the highest performing charter school network in New York City. In 11 years, her network has grown to 41 schools serving 14,000 children. Success Academy schools serve a high poverty population, yet they consistently outperform New York's most affluent school districts. On the most recent state exams, Success schools ranked in the top 0.3% of all New York schools in math and the top 1.5% in reading. On the math exam, the five highest scoring schools were all Success Academies. Success Academy has a wait list of 17,000 children. And to meet that demand, Moskowitz has pledged to expand to 100 schools over the next 10 years. And finally, we have John Katzman, an education entrepreneur. He's the founder and CEO of the Noodle Companies, a studio whose operating companies connect learners, educators, and technologies. Working with the Walton Family Fund, Noodle.com is rethinking choice and accountability. Prior to that, he founded and ran 2U, which works with research universities to create online degree programs. Before that, he founded and ran the Princeton Review, which helps students find, get into, and pay for colleges and universities. So we're going to go without opening statements. We're going to jump right into a Q&A, and I think I'll start with Eva. Eva, in a recent TV interview, you alluded to the not finished education reforms from the Obama years. So what is not finished in terms of Success Academies, in terms of charter schools in New York City, or charters nationally?
Sure. Well, you know, we've got some real challenges nationally in terms of the quality of schooling that we are offering. The most vulnerable children from poor socioeconomic backgrounds suffer the most, but all the international data indicates that even our more affluent school districts, when compared to places around the world, are not doing terribly well. My view is that education is a bipartisan issue and we need to treat it as such. And so, you know, we've got to double down on how we're going to get out of the educational quagmire that we're in. I mostly focus on K-12. When I hear about higher education, I get nervous too, but I have enough on my plate with K-12. I don't think we have a lot of time. I think that if we're going to get out from under a permanent underclass in America, we're going to have to very, very quickly change the trajectory. And that means everything from curriculum material to teacher training to leader training to the services that schools are offering. we're going to have a revolution in the way we think about schooling. In terms of success in particular, we are trying to scale at lightning speed. I always feel slow compared to Starbucks, but it's not so easy to get to 100 schools. We're serving 14,000 kids. Next year, we'll be at about 17,000 kids. And sometimes it feels a little bit like an emergency room in terms of the social challenges that our kids and families face. But then there's the teaching and learning, how to get kids the best math problems in the world. And how do you do that when teachers are not prepared necessarily to handle those math problems? So we've got challenges.
And just to follow up, do you see Trump DeVos helping you get to that goal or hindering?
Well, I think it's unclear. I don't have my crystal ball. And even if I did, I'm not sure I would be very good at predicting the future. But I support DeVos because I'm a strong supporter of parent choice. And so even though I'm a lifelong Democrat, I thought it was really, really important to have a Secretary of Education who understood the value of parent choice. Most affluent people have choices, and most poor people are trapped, unfortunately, in schools that have failed for decades. And so I see an incredible opportunity here. Now, opportunities can always be squandered, and there's a lot of venom in the sector. And my hope would be we could turn the temperature down and really focus on what are the set of public policies that are going to allow us in a rather short period of time. I would say we have maybe a decade at my most optimistic to kind of work our way out of the problems that they weren't made yesterday. They've been made for about a half a century.
Nina, essentially the same question for you. What's the unfinished business from point of view of the alliance, especially in light of, and it's actually your study that pointed out that the growth of charter schools, which had been quite dramatic, 6-7% a year for the past couple of decades, has come down to about 2%. So where are we going with charters?
Thanks, Richard. So let me answer that question and then go back to your first question. In terms of growth, we do a study every year that looks at how many new charter schools have opened and how many students are attending charter schools. And the enrollment numbers are at an all-time high of 3.1 million. So even though the total number of new schools wasn't as high as it has been in the past, in terms of the number of students we're serving, we're seeing a year-over-year growth, a pretty steady one. The other thing we track is waitlist numbers. And those numbers vary state by state and school by school, but we did a survey last year to look at whether parents are willing to send their children to charter schools. And one of the things we found is that even in those districts where parents don't have any charter schools or have never seen a charter school, there is demand for charter schools. So in terms of the unfinished business, in my opinion, it is figuring out a way to open a new high-quality public school in those places where parents have the need to send their children to these schools. The last piece also is actually something, going back to your first question, has to do with the outcome of the elections and to the extent we feel that we're not serving a certain segment of the population through charter schools or other ed reforms. So if you look at rural America, by and large, that's the area that for us as an organization, we've had the greatest challenge of expanding charter schools. And it's both because school boards have huge control over how things are run in these communities, but also because those communities know nothing more than the public school that they currently have. So when I think about unfinished business, I think about the wait lists and making sure we're meeting the needs of those parents who want to send their kids to these schools, but also figuring out a way to meet the needs of those families who don't actually know that this would be a good option, or those school district principals who would actually be better off if they had the flexibilities that chartering offers in exchange for academic achievement.
John, you've been looking at school accountability. What's the unfinished business in accountability? What are we holding schools accountable for now, and what should we be?
Sure. Everyone in this room agrees, and there's widespread agreement nationally on what we want from our K-12 schools, right? We want students who, over the next 30 years, are going to be employed in jobs that they really like and are engaged with. We want students who are going to be happy and healthy by a whole range of obvious metrics. And we want people who are going to be members of the community in good standing. They vote, they don't go to prison, they have friends in the community as well. We don't measure any of that as pertains to our schools. We're not actually looking at real outcomes for kids like mine. So what we're trying to do with Walton, and what I see this administration is actually more comfortable playing with in place of standardized tests and Common Core, is really looking at actual outcomes, number one. A student like your son, if he goes to this school versus this school, what happens? And number two, how do you take that information and put it in the hands of parents in a way that they're going to do something with it? So the best accountability is of the marketplace, right? BlackBerry did nothing wrong, except they didn't innovate quickly enough when Apple came along, and they were, you know, effectively out of business within a couple of years. Getting parents to use that data to make smart decisions is number two. And then the third part of the proposal, and I think what the administration is going to be very open to, is connecting that information with the actual admissions process. So I've decided to send my daughter to this school. How do we make it really easy to apply and to hear from the school and to finish the process? How do we create accountability that comes all the way through from really useful data to understandable to a decision and then an admit?
Now, this panel is supposed to have a heavy dose of political education politics, so let me get into a sticky one here, which requires setting a scene. Right now, voters in LA are picking a new school board, and the candidates there in LA who are supportive of charter schools have been under attack by the union, which has tried to associate them with Trump and DeVos, who are very unpopular there. And as we speak in New York, the unions are doing the same to Governor Cuomo, who's been a champion of charters in New York State, once again trying to tie charters to Trump and DeVos, and they think that they can gain some ground there. So the possibility of political backlash is apparent already. Now, so far, Trump and DeVos have mainly talked about tax credits, quasi-vouchers, if you will. But my question is, and I'll start with Nina, would the charter movement really be better off if the president and the secretary of education essentially just left charters alone and focused on tax credits and just let charters go their own way?
Well, when you think back this past fall, when the Massachusetts ballot initiative to expand charter schools in that state was on the ballot, Trump and DeVos were not in office, and that ballot initiative went down in flames because the unions and those who didn't support charter schools used every level possible to attack charters. So I don't know that you can necessarily say, because of this president and the secretary, that the outcome is going to dramatically be different unless you did a focus group of some kind or did a randomized field trial or asked people specifically, is this why you are voting against it? I think, unfortunately, this issue is very divisive in some of these school board elections in places like Los Angeles. And one of the things that I think our sector needs to do a much better job at is to make sure that people are, that they understand what's at stake and that they're showing up to vote in these board elections, which often take place at a time when no one is aware of them and where the other side has huge advantages because they notify their members and get them to show up. So I don't know if I answered your question, but I think the opponents in these situations will use every possible tool, and ultimately it is about voter turnout and your ability to get your side to show up. And our side just needs to do a much better job of mobilizing parents and those who actually believe that we need to have change in our public school system.
Eva, I can't imagine somebody who knows more about education politics, especially in New York, than you do. Is there a downside to this association with Trump and charters? Is there a backlash possibility? In other words, what Cuomo's facing right now?
I don't really know the time before the backlash. I didn't experience that, so I can't really say. As long I was in elected office a while back. And if you even wanted to look at certain issues, there was a target on your back from the teachers' union. You know, we have to do sort of hand-to-hand combat just to exist, even though there are now more powerful supporters of charter schools. But, you know, we've got quite a challenge in New York City. We have a mayor who's very, very hostile and makes it very, very difficult to wake up every day and provide the educational service that we are trying to provide in the rest of the sector. So I don't see it making things worse than they are. And look, education is still largely a state and local matter. I think we have to be careful not to fool ourselves into thinking that somehow it's going to become otherwise. It really gets determined very, very locally. There are some critical things that the federal government can do to make it easier or harder. But right locally, you know, the unions have captured state houses and city hall, and that makes it very challenging.
Yeah. John, you've been looking at vouchers, and it's clear that, you know, the new administration would like to go in that direction. Can you give us a little summary of what we know about the how good charters are doing, how well they're doing, how efficient and effective they are, and what's going to happen if they go in that direction?
So there are two ways to look at both charters and vouchers. One is, how do their students do over time, especially, again, looking longitudinally at actual outcomes we care about, like students end up going to college and so forth. And the other is, are they hurting the districts such that the city overall is worse off even if those students do better? So in terms of charters, we did a study, actually we haven't released it yet publicly, but it is really interesting. We looked at the percentage of students in each city who are in charters versus district schools. And then we looked at the change in NAEP scores for those cities over the past decade. And the question was, if there's a higher concentration of charters, do the districts improve more quickly? Do they decline? What happens to the students in the district? And the answer is, there's a 0.3 correlation that the higher the concentration of charters, the better that the district schools do, and the better that the city overall does. So I think charters, the jury's kind of in. You know, the data all points in one direction, which is this is overall not hurting districts, it's actually helping them. The data on vouchers is very different. It's all over the map in terms of actual academic outcomes, both for the students in those systems and for the districts that those students were taken from. And there are a lot of reasons that you could imagine that vouchers might be a problem. It's pretty early on, and there's not a lot of thoughtfulness in how we've implemented voucher systems. For instance, most systems, the same amount of money is on the back of every student. And so, since, you know, forgetting even special ed, every student has a different set of issues and needs, there are students who are a lot less expensive to educate, and you're going to encourage cherry picking. There is very little information in the hands of parents as to where to send their kids, very little accountability data for the private schools that you might send them to, and it's very hard, even as hard as it is to choose a charter or a district school, it's much even harder to choose a private school. So you've got an opaque marketplace with terrible metrics and a system that invites gaming. So I think right now, The data's not very good on vouchers, and where we're probably going to end up is small test systems to see if we can't do a better job before anybody commits real money to it.
Now, you know the difference between vouchers and charters, but what I'm seeing out there is this, you know, mashing up of the two. And I'm wondering what that means politically, especially for charters. Because the voucher record is not that great, as you point out. And I'm wondering if this could hurt charters. Nina, any thoughts?
They are different. So charter schools are public schools. And once you open, if you want to send your child to that school, you can go, you enroll. If there is a longer number of wait lists, you have to do a controlled, you have to do a lottery and so forth. So they are open to everyone. Whereas with a private school, unless there is a program in place, and they're not called vouchers in most states anymore, unless there is a means to get these parents into these schools, depending on the scholarship program or the tax credit program, it's going to look a little bit different. So I don't know how to answer your question other than to say that ultimately options are good for parents, and at the end of the day you have to make sure that you know, wherever the choice is taking place, that there is a degree of accountability for the schools that are accepting these funds, and that we have to make sure that the poor performing schools are closing and that the high performing ones are being scaled. And the only area, in my opinion, where this scaling has taken place effectively is in the charter school space. So if you are interested in creating more high quality public schools, the space that can do that right now and has the, you know, the human capital to take advantage of it is the charter school movement.
Let me stay on the political side for a moment here. I mean, it's clear that based on wait lists that there's still strong support for charter schools, especially among low-income parents. But I wonder about this slipping support among middle-class white parents. If you look at that Massachusetts vote, it was clear that the unions peeled off massive numbers of white middle-class suburbanites turned against charters. And I can see this possibly popping up elsewhere, and it's being twinned with the calls in lots of states for moratorium on charters. Is this a problem? Do you sense a slipping support among white middle class, Eva?
We serve a lot of them in mixed income schools. In New York, we have schools in more affluent neighborhoods. New York may be a little bit different. There's just incredible enthusiasm for innovation, for high quality. I've met with thousands of parents, and my experience is that parents don't care what you call them. They just want a high quality school, and they want it close to their neighborhood, and they'd like a K-12 system. I think it is the special interests and political interests that want to keep charters out of certain neighborhoods. When we opened on the Upper West Side, the unions were even more opposed to that than opening in Harlem or Bed-Stuy, because I think there was a sense that if middle-class parents are choosing an alternative, that is sort of the beginning of the end. And but I just don't think most parents are so political about it. They just want a good school. They want to know, to John's point, they want to know the kid is loved and their kid is happy and their kid is making measurable progress, and that there's a fair amount of communication between the school and parents. And then you could call the schools ishkabibble, and they're not going to care.
But as we saw in Massachusetts, sometimes those urban charter schools need the support of those middle class parents that don't even have any charter schools in the district, and they didn't get it. Is that worrisome, Nina?
Well, it is, except that what Eva's saying here is pretty important for our movement. I mean, to the extent you have an opportunity to take advantage of charter schools, you're more likely to support it. And in Massachusetts, we were basically telling these other families to support the growth of charter schools in select districts. So they had nothing to gain at the end of the day. And I think people do vote when they go to the ballot box with what's going to impact me the most. And in the case of Massachusetts, and in most states that have tried the ballot box to sell a value proposition through the referendum and initiative process, when the level of negativity of the issue goes up, voters either tend to vote no or they don't vote at all for that initiative. So I think there's something else going on around how people reacted that merits more attention than just whether they supported charter schools or not. So I think one of the things we need to do a better job at is, quite frankly, opening charter schools in areas that serve more middle-income families. I live in Virginia, a state that has a charter school law. I live in Northern Virginia. The school district has not opened a charter school, of course. And one of the things we're trying to do right now is change the law so that the state can also authorize charter schools in a place like that. So I would argue that if a good school were open, a lot of the families who are sending their kids to these really expensive private schools would actually take a look at the charter space pretty seriously, and that would really benefit our community tremendously. But it has been sold, I would say, over the past 5 to 10 years as mostly something that is there to serve the needs of the lowest income families, which, it, you know, ultimately, all things being equal, we all want to serve the needs of poor families first. That's where the need and demand is greatest. But in terms of becoming a real political force, I agree with Eva that you have to expand the base of support and go after those families who are actually registered to vote and are interested in a good education, regardless of, you know, where they're located.
John, how important do you think it is to get ramp up that support in places like the Newtons of the suburbs of the nation? And is it possible to do it?
I think it's really important, and it is possible. And the first thing, and the reason I first looked into the effect of charters on the district schools, is those same parents, even if they're not accessing charters, in Massachusetts bought into the narrative that more charters means that the district can do less good for their own kids. And we've got to make sure that it's very clear that the data says the reverse. Second, though, I think there's an opportunity to work with other schools of choice, with parochials and independent schools, and just argue that all of these schools, although they see each other as competitors to some degree, are schools of choice, are schools that you send your kid to because you think that that's the best fit. And that as we see each other as allies, that could be very powerful, because it's going to take a while to build a bunch of charter schools in more advantaged areas. Whereas right now, there are millions of students attending private and parochial schools who could be allies in this fight.
Let me shift gears a little bit. I saw that KIPP charter schools in Washington, D.C. just reduced their school hours. And part of the reason for doing that is because of competing for the best teachers. They're afraid of losing teachers to nearby school districts where the hours were not as long. And teachers aren't even the biggest part of it. School leaders are even more difficult to find, and facilities are nearly impossible. Which leads to my question, are charters at risk of hitting a wall here because of these kinds of limitations? Nina?
Limitations being long?
The high quality teachers mm-hmm. that they've been getting yeah. for years through TFA, the school leaders, the mm-hmm. buildings, is your movement going to hit a wall here because of these things?
I certainly hope not. I do think that the education space as a whole is probably, you know, realizing that in order to attract people who want to become teachers and stay in the teaching profession, that it needs to adjust to some extent to the new needs and demands of the millennial generation, who tend to be a little bit different in their work habits than the Gen Xers and the ones before. And Eva certainly may want to speak to that a little bit more. I think at the end of the day, what we need to do is quite simple. I think we need to make sure we have good pre-service and in-service training in our schools so that anyone who comes in has the ability to hit the ground running as fast as possible. It takes a couple of years for a teacher to actually become good at what they do. So hopefully the best thing that our leaders can, and a lot of them are doing already, is making sure that they are staying there long enough to have that kind of impact. But I don't know that it's really a charter problem as much as it's just the changing face of our workforce demands things that, you know, as a profession, we just need to make some changes along the way. But the pipeline really starts from the teacher education colleges. And with that reauthorization of the Higher Education Act, I do think there are some opportunities to really go into these teacher ed schools and make sure that they are training the teachers of tomorrow in a way that benefits our space, whether it's a charter or public or even the private schools.
Even any observations on recruiting teachers, getting high quality teachers? Over the years you've been doing this, is it getting harder and easier? And school, same question for school leaders.
There's nothing about public education that's easy. Or I haven't found it yet. Maybe it exists and I'm just somehow not in the loop. But Richard, I would suggest we kind of reframe the question, if I may, because, you know, the charter sector is often asked whether are we hitting various walls. I think the monopoly of public education has hit a wall. And I think there are ways in which the charter sector is part of that. I mean, the teacher shortage, to Nina's point, this is not a charter issue. This is a national problem. If you look at how many physics teachers are being produced by this country, it is not enough for all the kids who need to and want to take physics. I also think that it, as a sector, every other sector has reimagined the training of its workers. And education has been incredibly slow to do that. It has been incredibly slow to really imagine the ways in which technology can be helpful. The sector from kind of top to bottom needs to be rethought. I actually think the charter sector has a tremendous competitive advantage when it comes to innovation, because we are less subject to an octopus set of regulations that makes it incredibly difficult to rethink anything. Now, we don't have the kind of R&D budgets that a typical sector would have to do that kind of rethinking, but I am much more optimistic about the charter sector's ability to innovate than the district.
Yeah, John, any observations here?
Just one. Yeah. I mean, to some degree, that the charter schools are the women of K-12 in that they get about 70% of the funding of the rest of schools. And to some degree, if we start addressing equality of funding, I think the charter schools could solve this problem by simply raising salaries some. They're squeezed pretty tight.
I'm wondering if there's a natural limit on charter schools. I mean, I look at, I live in Washington, D.C., where there's about 45% charter right now. And I don't see a big clamor on the charter side to go past 50% necessarily. Everyone seems kind of happy with that balance. And I guess you have to look at this city by city, but it does raise the question of, is there a natural balance of charter versus district that seems to be, if we're getting a glimpse into that?
You want me to answer that first? Yeah. So I think it depends on the community and what they want and what they need. And so in DC, you can open up to 20 new charter schools every year, and they have one authorizer who actually does a very nice job of going to conferences like these and others to identify the right operator to come to DC to apply. And they have done a nice job not only of serving the needs of the families who want to attend charter schools, but also attracting those operators who are interested in going after specific needs communities like homeless children or students with disabilities. I don't think that DC is happy with 50%. I think, it is what it is right now, but it's growing pretty steadily, and it can continue to grow regardless of what happens in the city, because the law was enacted by Congress and it sits outside of whatever happens with DCPS and with the mayor's office. In other places, it's different. In New Orleans, almost every public school, if not all of them, are now charter schools. In Flint and Detroit, a good portion of students are attending charter schools. So it really depends on exactly what the needs of the community are, how well the traditional system is reacting to the growth of charter schools, if they are, in fact, coming up with ways to innovate in their system. And in other places, it's going to be a function of, you know, parental demand. So in Minnesota, the demand is not as high for whatever reason. People are happy with their traditional schools or their private schools. So we don't have a limit really in mind. As I said earlier, for us, it's just about making sure that every parent who wants a choice has access to a high quality public school. And for us, charters are one of the best and quickest ways to make that possible, but it will take a good law and the, you know, political will at the local level to allow that leader to access facilities and to be able to open and run an effective school.
What about New York, Eva? Do you have a sense of what, you look out at 10 years, what is there a natural balance that you see New York headed toward?
I mean, the appetite, I think, is just enormous for alternatives. The charter sector in New York surpassed the 100,000 mark this past year, and it took 18 years to get to 100,000. I think we will be at 200,000 in 4 years, and I still don't think that will satisfy the demand. I think one question is, are there enough social entrepreneurs to really satisfy that level of demand? And I think, to John's point, if we can get equitable funding, if we can make the regulatory apparatus more reasonable, if we can deal with the facilities challenges, I think you'll see people going into the space and offering many more you know, kinds of schools. In Harlem, we have the highest concentration per square mile of charters anywhere in the United States. There is true competition there. You know, parents don't like KIPP, they can come to Success. If they don't like Success, they can go to a single-sex school. If they don't like a single-sex school, they can go to a traditional. We happen to be very progressive. They have these enormous number of choices. And I think it's quite exciting, and people predicted that parents wouldn't be able to navigate. I think parents are sometimes underestimated. They're perfectly capable of kicking the tires and figuring out and, frankly, navigating a one-page application, et cetera. So parents in Harlem are applying for 10, 12 schools, and you know, they're really interviewing. Well, what is your curriculum, and how do you compare to these 7 other charter schools? They're quite savvy consumers of education.
Yeah, John, any thoughts before we head off to questions? Do you see a natural balance coming?
I don't think there's any one natural balance, but the better we make the choice systems, the easier we make it. And Eva correctly points out that parents are somehow navigating this patchwork we have right now. If we make it easier, if we make the data better and more useful, I think the pent-up demand for charter schools will double or triple.
Well, let's move to questions. I don't see any Slido questions yet. Maybe they'll, oh yes, okay. First question. Okay, why is there no district public representation on this panel right now? I think we need somebody from South by Southwest to answer that question, because we answered an invitation to come here. I suppose that it's because they wanted to talk about where the school reform movement was headed. But that's really a question for them. Why build new schools instead of fixing the ones that we already have? If we have public education in this country, why not focus, invest, and fix it?
You know, I think it's a really good and important question. From my perspective, and again, I'm sorry, I'm such a New Yorker, but, you know, I've witnessed for about, you know, half a century, tremendous investment in the district school system. And I think you see that playing out nationally. If you look at the $7 billion that was spent on the lowest 5% of schools in this country, and it didn't move the needle. I myself tried for 6 years. I went to district schools in New York City. My children went to district schools. I spent 6 years, 24/7, trying to improve the district. And it is there are wonderful people in the New York City school system, incredibly talented and dedicated people, but it's very hard to change the system. It is incredibly impervious to parental demand. It is incredibly impervious to teacher demand. When teachers want to change things, the system does not respond fast or effectively. And so I personally made the decision that rather than spend my time and energy, which I did for many, many years, to improve a system that seemed very, very fundamentally broken, I personally was going to spend my time trying to reimagine public education and really figure out what would it be like to get it right from the get-go. And I haven't always done that, and its success is very much a work in progress. But what would it be like to have kids really love coming to school, have teachers who are nurturing, to have a system of delivery that not only worried about math and science and writing and project-based learning, but one that also gave kids a great experience in terms of the visual arts and dance and sports and chess and debate. And it's easier to do that when you're not starting with all the obstacles. So that's my answer to that question.
And the only thing I'll say is I think we should do both. We should invest in fixing the system and making options available, because every minute that a child is attending a school that we know is not delivering results is a minute that they cannot take back. And you can't tell a parent, let's just keep your child in here until we figure out how to fix it. At the federal level, I believe we've now spent $6 billion. Is that the figure for SIG? Yeah. $6 billion has been expended on the school improvement grant program. This is a program that was targeted at the lowest performing, bottom worst performing schools around the country. And the latest body of research that came out of the department, I believe, indicated that that money hadn't really made a difference in improving the test scores in those schools. Most of these schools are high schools. They're schools that have been failing for a large number of years over and over. And one of the things we've been saying is, let's bring some of our highest performing charter operators into these schools and see if some of the innovations in chartering can actually make a difference. But you have to be open to that. You have to be open to bringing new leadership and empowering that leader to really make a lot of changes quickly, and also to give them the right kind of resources to do so.
But I think we're seeing some of that openness. And I've spent some time in Newark, and you know, anybody who's read about Newark, it's a pretty tough political climate there. And I profiled the Alexander Street School, which was just a horrible failing school, and then it was turned over to Uncommon and Uncommon Charter Schools. And in 1 year, Uncommon turned it around with the same kids who had been there year before. It was a transformation school. And then Newark Public Schools, at first they were very hesitant, because, oh man, there must be something wrong with this data here. They came in and scrubbed all the data and said, yeah, Uncommon actually did this. And so now Newark Public Schools is working with Uncommon, is sharing some leadership training, et cetera, to see if they can take some of the Alexander Street lessons and apply to Newark Public Schools. So, you know, I think there's real potential there and a real openness. John, any?
No.
Okay. Next question. Charters are a choice, sometimes a better choice, but not always. How do we hold failing charters accountable? Nina, that's probably you first.
I believe we need to close them. If they're failing, if they haven't met the terms of their charters, they should be closed.
I agree.
That's a pretty clear one. Okay, as prominent members of the charter community and also as white women, do you relinquish power when your perspective may not best inform the needs of students? I understand that one, but if you...
I'm not sure what the question is.
Okay. We'll move to the next one. How does choice apply to families that can't access those choices? Language barrier, won't those students be left in the abandoned public school?
Again, the data says that the public schools where there are a higher concentration of charters outperform, not underperform. So they are losing some funding, they're losing some students, but net-net, they're improving. So I'm not sure I buy the narrative that the students who are left behind in the public schools are being done a disservice. That said, the better we make the choice system, the more we hold all schools in it accountable, the better for everybody.
I just find, as an operator, that you can overcome those language barriers by doing outreach in multiple languages. And we do at Success Academies, we do door-to-door. We don't consider it harassment till we've knocked on your door 6 times. So in Harlem, we have 80-90% of the age-eligible families applying for the lottery. So I'm not saying there isn't any family that doesn't have some barrier. But actually, applying to a charter in New York is a lot easier than registering your kid for kindergarten at the district school. There you have to actually show up in person. There's got to be someone at the desk at that moment in time. It's actually pretty easy. You put your name, your child's date of birth on a piece of paper, and you're done.
Yeah, I mean, the book before this last one was On the Rocket Ship, which is about a group of charter schools out of San Jose. And they focused on East San Jose, which is 100% Hispanic, and their school populations were 100% Hispanic. I mean, those were the kids who were falling behind, and I can assure you that they had no trouble recruiting kids to come in there, and it wasn't a language barrier at all. And it was interesting choice, too, because at Rocket Ship, it was English-only instruction. At the neighborhood schools, it was usually a mix of Spanish and English. So it's not like necessarily one is better, but parents had the choice. If you wanted that mix, you stayed in the neighborhood school. If you wanted your child to be instructed only in English, then you came to Rocket Ship School.
Well, I mean, I was also going to say, I spent 4 years at the U.S. Department of Education in the early 2000s, and one of the things we commissioned was a study that looked at how some of the innovations in the chartering space were being emulated by the traditional system. And one of the things that surfaced through the study is that a lot of school districts are actually using the outreach tactics of charter schools in order to attract and keep students in their system. Miami-Dade was one of them. So there are some really, because charters are schools of choice and they have to attract parents in order to keep their doors open, there are actually a lot of lessons in how we have been able to attract families and get them engaged and to stay in our schools. In fact, a study by Education Next this last year demonstrates that the level of effort in engaging parents in charter schools is higher than that in the traditional system and in the private school system. So there are things that we're doing which are worth taking a closer look at. And these questions are coming from anonymous sources, but I would love to know who they are so that I can take them to some of these schools so that they can see how it's done.
I feel like we've discussed the next question up, so I'm going to go ahead.
I would like to say something on that, and I should have said it before, because I did help think through who might be on this panel. Secretary DeVos is faced with ESSA is already law. She's unlikely to change the stance of the federal government towards traditional K-12 district schools dramatically. I think the major initiatives that she's been talking about and that the president's been talking about pertain to charters, pertain to vouchers, and potentially to accountability, although only peripherally. So what we thought is that this is the area that is likely to be relevant to a look ahead of this administration.
Yeah. I feel like we've already talked about the one on the top there, so let me skip here. How do the neighborhood public schools recover after they lose many of the motivated students and teachers to charter schools? Are they not destined to fail?
Well, we don't get too many teachers from the district, the nearby district schools. We can compete on salary. We put our resources into salary, so we pay our teachers somewhere between 15% and 20% more, but we can't honestly compete on the pension system. We put in a percentage and the employee puts in a percentage. Where we can compete, I think, is the level of, district schools where we are co-located are very chaotic. And so I think one of the reasons that teachers like working in the charter sector is they can actually teach and there isn't a level of chaos in the classroom or in the lunchroom. It's also the level of professional support that we are able to give our teachers. We do 13 weeks of professional development every year for both new and returning teachers. We really find that teachers need a high level of support. It's quite the craft and the art form to be a truly phenomenal teacher. And the district schools are not giving that level of professional development that our teachers really enjoy. But I don't see it as sort of one or the other. I always like to say, you know, we don't grow babies or children in test tubes. If they're in this district system and they come to us, then that's money that the system doesn't have to spend educating. The system is quite elastic, so we have a number of teachers that meet the number of students, and the district has the same. And to Nina's point, if we were a little more open, then we could learn a lot. I've learned a tremendous amount from district schools in New York City. I've visited 300 district schools. The district doesn't always come to visit us, but I find there's a tremendous amount we could be learning from one another if we were sort of open to that.
Well, the questioner is suggesting that the New York public schools are losing their most motivated students to success academies. And don't you think there's something to that? I mean, if I'm a parent in New York City and I know that I'm sending to your school, I know that they're going to get incredibly challenging curriculum, et cetera, and so therefore I'm a parent who aspires to that. So don't you automatically get a more motivated child?
I mean, look, there have been some gold standard lotteried in and lotteried out studies that suggest if you attend a Success Academy school, that yes, the amount of academic growth you're going to experience is quite great. I find you have to be pretty motivated to register your kid for kindergarten to get into a district school. So I don't know. Do we have more motivated? I don't know how you would know that, right? You can't simply say, well, parents are applying because they're also registering their kid for kindergarten. I find we have a pretty wide range of levels of motivation. I think to Nina's point, we go to great lengths to inspire our parents. I think it's a little bit of a myth that they just sort of come and they're when you ask our parents why are they coming to Success, it's a little deflating sometimes because they often say safety. They don't say our wonderful science curriculum, discovery-oriented science 5 days a week. They don't say, oh, we love your chess program. We find we have to really inspire our parents around the sacrifices we as educators are willing to make and the sacrifices we want our parents to make, and we have to create those communities. They're not just handed to us. It takes incredible, intricate work to build a magical educational community, and I don't see many of the district schools doing that. Having sent my own kid to district schools, and often people are not answering the phone. They don't have an open door policy. You can't watch the instruction in your kid's school. There are many sort of barriers to parental involvement in your typical district school.
You know, essentially you're asking about cherry picking here.
But I guess, as a parent, I'm just going to turn this back on me. It is actually very difficult to decide to move your child from a school to another school because they've created, peer networks, you're comfortable with the bus route or the road that you take to take your child to that school. So I actually think when a parent decides they are going to move their child, it is for a pretty compelling reason. And so the question I wish were phrased a little differently, which is, why is it that a parent would want to send their child or take them out of an existing school to another school if that school is actually meeting their needs? So I guess I don't really buy into the way this question is framed. But as Eva mentioned, when you do randomized field trials, and the best ones have been done in New York and Boston, one of the things you find is that regardless of parental motivation, something in that charter sauce in these two sectors is having an impact on student achievement. So in those spaces where they have done controlled trials, they have seen that chartering is improving your academic outcome.
And the trials that she's referring to are those who apply for the lottery and don't get in. So they can track those child through that child through the traditional public school and compare them then to the children who did get in.
So I'll answer that question and the one that's coming. again, the data is that district schools do better when there's a higher concentration of charters. They don't do worse, they don't fail. And so I don't know exactly the mechanism where that happens. And it could be different in different districts, but it happens. And when I asked the question originally, in the aftermath of the Massachusetts vote, I really had no idea what the answer is. It turns out there's a lot of other studies that say the same thing, that the effect of charters is to improve the district, not to destroy the district. And so that's just the data. Similarly, the data on vouchers is exactly the opposite of this question. It is that they haven't done well, that students receiving vouchers haven't done that well, and that the districts in voucher areas have suffered for it. So it is a very different situation, charters and vouchers. And what I was actually arguing for, if we are going to walk down the road of vouchers at all, we should do it very small. We should do it in ways that are much tougher to game. And we should track things and make sure that this is actually having a positive impact before we spend a lot of money on a rabbit hole.
I got the sign to do a wrap-up here, so maybe we'll just go in order and take it back to politics. What would you like to see happen in the next 4 years that could, where your organization or your cause would be helped by the president and the secretary? What would you want from them?
I think you know the answer to that. I think for us, it's always going to be about funding, making sure that there is enough funding available to launch new charter schools and to make sure that there's funding available for charter school facilities. As John mentioned, on average, charter schools receive only 70 cents of every dollar that follows students through the traditional system. And in a lot of places, that is facilities finance that is not available for charter schools. So you could argue 25 years ago, we were new. There was no imperative to make sure that we had our own facilities, but 25 years in the making, with over 6,900 charter schools around the country, in 43 states and Washington, D.C., I still think that, you know, the fact that we haven't figured out the facilities finance piece is a pretty, you know, strong impediment to our growth. And so figuring out that puzzle or that piece of the puzzle will be really important to our growth and our success in the long run.
Yeah, Eva, same question. Going the next 4 years, what do you see that you would like to see happen that Washington could help you with?
I mean, Nina, I think, laid it out. I would just say something more basic, which is we need educational leadership in this country. We need the American public to understand the urgency of the matter. And we need a real champion of teaching and learning. Parents want great schools. They don't really care what they're called. Every community needs a great K-12 system, and right now that is not the case. You know, I'm very focused on the New York politics and policies, and locally, the big impediment to providing more high-quality seats is the real estate. And it's not that the real estate doesn't exist. It does. It's just really changing the dynamic so that the mayor and the chancellor treat charters like the public schools that they are.
Yeah. John, next 4 years?
Yeah, I'm a lifetime Democrat, as is Eva. And as charter supporters who voted for Hillary were something of friends of an enemy in this particular case. And it's a tricky situation. As you said, I'd be highly supportive of an initiative to help charter schools with construction costs more effectively, as I would be supportive of the administration putting $1 trillion into infrastructure. But I'm worried that that the embrace of this administration is not in the long-term best interest of charters. It is what it is. And the better the data is, the better the research is around the impact of charters on the whole city, not just the students who go to charters, the more we can prove our case.
Do you fear a backlash?
I do.
Yeah. So do I. But I agree with you. Well, listen, that wraps up our time. So I want to thank our panelists and thank you guys for your great questions.